I think we're good to go.
All right. Well, welcome everyone. Thank you so much for being here. Robin and I are really excited to dig into this guidance manual a little bit more deeply. Hopefully some of you were able to go to the overview session that was a couple of weeks ago. And just make sure you're aware this is the first of three sessions where we'll be pulling apart different sections of the guidance manual. And we can start with introducing ourselves. I'm April Perkins, and I'm the English for Speakers of Other Languages specialist at the Maine Department of Education.
And I'm Robin Fleck. I'm an ESOL consultant working with April and Rebecca Carey at the Department of Education.
And you'll notice that we do have subtitles going for today's meeting. Hopefully that helps improve our accessibility for everyone. There may be mistakes in those subtitles. So just know if you see anything strange, it's probably a bad transcription. Okay.
And I think it would be helpful if everyone could mute themselves during the presentation. And if you have questions, if you could enter them into the chat, and we'll try to address those as they come up.
Those of you who were present at the overview session recently, some of these first few slides, the information that's on these slides might feel like a little bit of a review, but we wanted to make sure that everyone who's here with us today is on the same page and understands the purpose and genesis of this guidance manual. So these are our general learning goals for today. We're going to talk with you about the legal requirements for identifying a student who's a multilingual learner with a disability, talk about some myths and facts, obligations and timelines. We'll talk about the intervention process when a student is suspected of having a disability, and guidance to determine if the student's challenges are language acquisition, disability, or both. And very important note to make sure everyone's aware of, I think most of you probably have heard this news already. It happened last March, I think, that the Maine Department of Education made a shift in terminology so that whereas in the past we spoke about students as English learners, we have now begun referring to them as multilingual learners. And the reason for that change is that we want to be very deliberate and intentional in our use of asset-based language. The term English learners focuses on what students are working towards, whereas multilingual learners focuses on what they have as assets. And many of our students are not only bilingual, but multilingual. So that's why we've decided to use that term. And we encourage you to adopt it in your own setting to the greatest extent that you can. Okay, so just to give you a little bit of history of how this came to be, this is something that I think we've known was needed for a very long time, many years. And different people have kind of thrown ideas and information into the pot. And it took quite a while for us to get to this point where we had a guidance manual that we felt was strong, that we felt sure that it had everything in it that you might need. That said, it's always going to be a work in progress, and we'll continue to revise it and add and change things over the years as needed. So we welcome you as you start to use this guidance manual. I would love for you to reach out with any feedback, anything that you feel could be elaborated on more, anything that's missing, please do feel free to let us know, and we'd love to continue to revise the document. We thank the Virginia Department of Education for allowing us to use the great work that they had done in putting together their own guidance manual as a foundation for ours. So if you're familiar with the Virginia document, the structure is largely the same as the structure that we've used, but we spent a lot of time and effort making sure that it aligns with our Maine context. So we included all of our Maine legal references and information that seems to fit our specific context here in Maine. I also want to make sure you know that this isn't something that just Robin and I, or just the ESOL term team worked on, but it was a cross-department collaboration. between our team and the Special Services and Inclusive Education team. And that is a new name for that team as well, in case you haven't heard that news. It used to be referred to as the Special Services team and is now the Special Services and Inclusive Education team. In addition to those Department of Education staff, the guidance manual went through the hands of many other experts out in the field, including Dr. Melissa Cuba at the University of Maine, Sylvia DeRuvo and the National Center for Systemic Improvement, of course, Robin, who is here with us as an ESOL consultant, Maureen, who also worked with us as an ESOL consultant, MAST, and the Multilingual Learner Advisory Council. The guidance manual was reviewed, and we adjusted things based on feedback from all of these individuals and groups.
And as you can see, we have a lot in this manual. It's about 54 pages long, I think. And you can see the various contents listed. And today we are going to be focusing on the legal requirements and the intervention procedures. And in our follow-up workshops, we'll be going through other components of the manual.
So as a foundation for this work, the legal requirements stem from the IDEA, which is the Individuals with Disabilities in Education Act, our Maine Special Education Regulations, or MUSER, as you might have heard it referred to, federal civil rights law, primarily that would be Title VI of the Civil Rights Act, which guarantees equitable access to school for students who are multilingual, and the Every Student Succeeds Act, or ESSA.
It is a fact. Whoopsie, my slide. Okay. All right. It's a fact that the IDEA and the Federal Civil Rights Guidance prohibits a policy of delaying evaluations of multilingual learners to determine the need for special education and related services over a specified period of time, purely based on the student's English language proficiency or multilingual learner status. And we often hear from school districts that they think the student cannot be referred for a suspected disability because they haven't been in the country long enough. Educators do face an ongoing challenge in distinguishing a learning disability from the typical challenges of learning a second language. When a multilingual learner doesn't learn English at an expected pace, falls behind academically, or exhibits inappropriate behavior, educators need to determine whether the issues caused by a learning disability, difficulty in developing second language skills, is it trauma, is it cultural adjustment? There's a lot of factors to consider.
And what we really concluded as we did the work of putting together this guidance manual is that determining whether a student who is a multilingual learner also has a disability is more of an art than it is a science. It's not that you're going to open this guidance manual and find specific and clear answers about a specific situation. More what the guidance manual does for you is gives you ideas about the information that you can collect to get as global and holistic a picture of a student as you can, so that that student's team of educators can come together and review all of those different pieces of information to make the best determination that they can. So the rigid protocols that that might feel comfortable and more certain for educators won't be found in this guidance document, because those protocols might not work very well in the case of a multilingual learner. So it really does require patience, creativity, innovation, and thinking outside of the box to really get a clear understanding of what a student's needs are to be able to make a determination. So the next part of the presentation talks about the procedures that you might use. First and foremost, as we said, we want to talk about some of the myths that exist around multilingual learner status and disability. And so a common myth is that students will learn English or any language by being exposed to it, just that kind of sink or swim, total immersion approach. And it is true that students will gain language over time. However, ESOL programming is absolutely essential for students to support them in acquiring academic language and in developing their language as quickly as possible. Because of course, for multilingual learners, English is an essential tool for them to access their education. So we want to support them in acquiring it quickly and efficiently so that they can access their education independently as soon as possible.
So the manual explores some of the factors that go into a misidentification situation. And if you refer to Chapter 6 of the U.S. Department of Education English Learner Toolkit, they identify four potential factors that could contribute to the misidentification of special education needs and learning disabilities among students who are multilingual learners. And those four are poor instructional practices, the evaluating professionals' lack of a knowledge base regarding second language development and disabilities, weak intervention strategies, and inappropriate assessment tools. And each of these four factors is addressed in depth in the intervention procedures section of the guide. Also like to add that we want to keep in mind the linguistic differences between languages and students that can often be referred to speech when the issue is a linguistic issue rather than a language development or articulation need. And it tends to be a common occurrence with our younger children, that they're being referred to speech even as young as ages 3 to 5. And we know that all children are developing their foundation of language. And when you are doing that with more than one language, your timeline is perhaps going to be a little bit different than if you are a monolingual learner. And we know that all languages don't have the same sounds. So that's really important to keep in mind as you're thinking about students and their needs with speech.
These are indicators, or in other words, signs that an educator might observe that would begin to cause them to question whether the student might possibly have a disability. That said, there could be lots of factors contributing to each of these three cases. So if a multilingual learner is not acquiring English at an expected pace, perhaps as compared to other similar peers, if a multilingual learner is not making the expected academic progress, or is exhibiting inappropriate behavior frequently. Those would be three scenarios where an educator might have a reasonable cause to begin to question. As the guidance manual clarifies, there are lots of other questions that need to be asked around these three scenarios before we would go down the route of considering evaluating for a disability.
And I'll share a quick example. Are we good now? Okay. Yep. And I can think of an example of a student who was new to school, had not had a pre-K experience, and several months into the year was still in a silent phase. And not participating and interacting with peers as one might expect a child of that age to be doing. Upon further exploration with the family, there were other siblings at the school. The father was in jail. And this particular child was more affected than the other children in the family, as the family's situation turned around in the future. This child did not need any services through special education, needed some extra TLC and some understanding, and went on to, I'm old enough to say, graduate from Orono. but that was a case where the classroom teacher, you know, thought that perhaps we needed to make a referral. Oh, is it me? Okay. So some of the other questions that need to be examined and responded to before a referral for a special education evaluation is made is the district ESOL plan, the LAO plan, being implemented within the school? Does everybody in your school know that your district has a LAO plan? Do they know where to access the LAO plan? If your staff don't know that there is such a thing as a LAO plan, how can it be fully implemented? So that's something that all staff members should be aware of. And if you're in a position to share that information with staff at your school, we hope that you'll do that. Is the student's ILAP, their Individualized Language Acquisition Plan, inclusive of language goals and benchmarks and available to all educational staff? Does your staff even know what an ILAP is? Do they know where to find it? And as an ESOL educator, are you sharing that with staff or making them aware of how to find it? If you create that ILAP electronically, just a little tip, you're probably much more adept at this than I am, but if you do it electronically, it's so much easier to share and create a Google Doc to be able to progress monitor. And are the modifications, adaptations, or differentiation strategies that are within the ILAP being used in the classrooms? Do you have a way to communicate with your classroom and content area teachers to know if they are using those recommendations? Are the recommendations helpful? Are they struggling? Do they need to meet with you and come up with some new ideas? So those are important things to keep in mind. Okay.
And beyond that, really taking a close look at the student's English language acquisition programming or ESOL services to determine whether the sufficient nature of those services is a factor in the student's progress. So is the student being taught by a teacher who is certified and qualified to teach ESOL, who understands the strategies that are necessary for the student to gain English language and content? Is the student growing as expected on the English language proficiency assessment? And if not, digging into the factors that could be contributing to that. And then asking, have the teachers been regularly meeting to discuss the student's progress and providing supports as needed so that that student's getting intervention along the way? And then other things to think about as you're deciding whether or not a student might be evaluated include how much the family has been involved in the student's education. Have they had an opportunity to meet with the student's educators and share information about the student's behaviors and linguistic performance, I guess we could say, and challenges that they might be experiencing within the home?
And April, yeah. Can I just chime in for a minute there? And you want to be listening carefully to what your parents share with you. But if there's a mismatch from what parents are sharing with you and what you are experiencing and observing with the student, it's very important to spend more time. And if there are any records from the school, if there is any kind of medical records or from another district, to look carefully at those, and then to think about more probing questions with the parent. And I think of an example of a child that was at kindergarten registration who was presenting with some specific needs. The parent indicated that the child's development was on par with older siblings' development. Okay. Once we got school records from older siblings, we could see that there were developmental delays with those older siblings. So for that parent, that child was on par. Okay, so we couldn't just go by that information. So it's just one little example of how sometimes there's a mismatch and you really have to kind of take a deeper dive into things.
And finding out more about the student's life at home is so essential, because you need some basis of comparison to say, is it the environment that could be contributing to the student's behavior or challenges? If the student, for example, never has a meltdown at home, but has frequent meltdowns at school, it could be stress related to the school environment or trauma manifesting itself in that way, rather than a cause for concern around disability.
Right.
Go ahead, Robin.
Well, I was just going to say, if the students have come from an unsafe environment and families have had to keep the children in a protective environment, they may not have had the opportunity to develop, particularly if they're at a young age and they haven't had the opportunity to practice gross and fine motor skills. And it may not be a case of there being a disability, but that there was a lack of opportunity. And so if you find out that someone, you know, basically lived in a shelter for 18 months while the student was from, you know, age 4.5 to 6, okay, then that student is going to need to have enriched opportunities to support the growth there, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they require special education services.
And in addition to that, it's very important to consider cultural factors and whether the environment that they're in is culturally responsive for them, because a culturally responsive school environment helps a student to feel comfortable and relax and feel at home and safe in school, which may reduce some of the behaviors or responses that we're seeing in students who don't feel that sense of comfort. Keeping a close eye on the student's progress through informal and formal observations and assessments, and making sure that the assets that the student has are being leveraged throughout the student's education. Okay, and then MTSS. So this is a term that might not be familiar for everyone here, so I'll quickly define that MTSS is multi-tiered system of supports, which are it's a framework that includes all academic, social, behavioral, and emotional needs that a student might have in one comprehensive system. So that might include RTI, it might include PBIS, it includes every aspect of who the student is, so that they're being looked at holistically and receiving the supports they need in each of those different realms. You want to add anything to that, Robin?
No, I don't think so. I think that's good. Okay. All right. So step one. Okay. And this intervention procedures flowchart is in the manual, and there's a nice graphic for you to kind of follow through and be able to share with others. So we're looking for students to receive culturally and linguistic responsive instruction using instructional strategies that integrate language and content acquisition. And we are strongly encouraging all content area teachers to be establishing language goals along with their content area goals for all lessons. So when a teacher is seeing that the progression of instructional strategies are not producing academic progress, then the teacher needs to document the student progress. And if it's a behavioral issue, and contact the parents and guardians, and always the communication needs to be provided in a language that parents can understand through a qualified interpreter if that's needed. It's really important for there to be consistency with the instructional strategies that are provided through the classroom content teacher and the ESOL teacher. So if the ESOL teacher is focusing on language goals and presenting information in one way, and the classroom and content teacher, they might have some of the same goals, but they're using a very different approach, it can be confusing. It could be supportive to have two different ways of doing things, but this is where the collaboration piece is so important between the ESOL teacher and the classroom content area teacher, so that everybody is on the same page and can consistently monitor what is working and what is not working. The academic and language needs of multilingual learners who might otherwise be suspected of having a disability and referred for special education services, again, can be addressed through this teacher collaboration. And teams can design and effectively implement instructional strategies. Again, that requires that collaboration, that common planning time. And we know that that's always a challenge for teachers to find that collaboration time, that common planning time. But it's really important to make that happen, especially when you are concerned that there's indicators of a suspected disability. This is really crucial in that pre-referral process. Anything else, April?
I think that's good. And then once you have addressed this and attempted those supports and seen how the student has responded to the supports, if there is an ongoing concern, then you would progress to step two, which would be pulling together the school team to really look closely at the student's performance and progress and consider all of the factors that we've discussed during today's presentation. Robin, you have some notes on this one too.
Well, I think just to think about who the members of your team are, to maybe have that established, and how will you present your documentation, and how will you demonstrate your areas of concern, rather than just to say, oh, you know, there's a problem. Have everything organized, put together, and know what specifically you are looking to address and how are you going to document it and demonstrate it to the members of your team? So that will accelerate the process of developing an intervention plan moving forward. And should I go ahead to step three? Yeah, okay. So your school team, that intervention plan should include consistent interventions. And really, for an intervention to be effective, it should be occurring at least 3 times a week. Follow-up meetings are recommended, if possible, every 2 weeks to check in. So that if you need to revise or adapt that intervention plan, that can happen. An evaluation of student progress after a 6-week mark, if the service delivery has been able to be consistent and the student has had regular attendance, is a recommendation of getting together. And during that time period, you also want to be collecting the information from the family, as we talked about earlier, and exploring some of those sociocultural factors and also the linguistic factors that might be part of all of this.
Okay, so then step four is when all of those previous steps have been completed and there is a suspicion based on the evidence that has been gathered thus far that there may be a disability for the student. So the team discusses the factors that are at play that have led them to suspect that there's a disability and follows the appropriate steps to adhere to special education timelines. And as we've mentioned a few times throughout today's presentation, the use of interpreters is very essential so that families can be involved in the process, have a clear understanding of their rights, and understand all of the information about their child's progress and the suspected disability.
And anyone can make a referral to special education. The team may feel it's most appropriate to encourage the parents to do so, or the school team may decide to make the referral themselves. And these particular notes come from Leora Byris, one of our special education specialists. It says, in either event, the special education director of the district should be contacted and the referral should be made in writing. And if a family needs interpreting or translation services, that needs to be a part of this process. Once the referral is received by the district, the evaluation clock begins, 45 school days for students ages 5 to 20 and 60 calendar days for students being served by CDS, Child Development Services. The multilingual learner team should be included in the meetings to discuss what evaluations might be recommended to understand the student needs. And the ESOL staff should be in every IEP team meeting throughout the student's special education journey. Those are comments that Leora shared with us.
So those are all of the prepared slides that we have for you. Of course, this section of the guidance manual that we provided an overview of today includes much more depth and detail, but we hope that this has given you a good glimpse of what it contains and I'm sure has probably raised many questions for you as well. So we wanted to make sure to reserve plenty of time today for you to be able to pose those questions. So you're welcome to do so. And let me just take a look at the chat. I don't think any questions have come in the chat that we need to respond to at this time. But if you have one, you're welcome to add it there or unmute and speak. And if there aren't any questions at this time, I'm sure that as you dig into this guidance manual and begin to apply it in your own instructional practice and in your own school setting, that those questions are going to come up, and you're welcome to contact Robin and or me. I see that there is a question in the chat which says, are there any special considerations for older students, for example, high school age, when considering RTI and referral?
I would say that April and I were speaking of this earlier, your special educators at the high school level don't have very many first referrals coming through at the high school level. Typically, a student's needs have been identified before they get to high school. However, our students, if they're just coming to us, they're newcomers and they have these needs. So that can be a new experience for your special educators. However, they do follow the same process. And it can be a case of needing to collaborate with the ESOL staff to learn more about the linguistic, the socio-cultural factors, the translation pieces, the communication pieces. And I see that Ian is sharing that they have a lot of first referrals at our high school. Ian, do you want to chime in and share a little bit more about that? Put me on the spot.
Sure. Yep, sure. Hi. I'm the special ed team leader at Casco Bay High School, and we do get quite a lot of first referrals in our high school, not necessarily from MLs, but in the last 2 days, I've already processed three special ed referrals from kids who are, I'd say, in 9th through 11th grades. And our high school is only 391 kids.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Just a little anecdotal evidence there for everyone, for whatever it's worth.
There's another question in the chat that says, are there suggested tools for the academic evaluation portion of the special education testing to use with multilingual learners? And this is something that we spend a lot of time talking about as well within our office, because most tools have been developed in English. There are very, very few tools available that are in other languages. And as long as a student is identified as a multilingual learner, they are by definition not proficient in English. So evaluating them with a tool that is designed and administered in English will give you results of limited meaningfulness. So if you look into the guidance manual, you'll see that we recommend a few potential ways of addressing that. And it's dependent on that student and their particular needs and what might yield the most meaningful results for them. So we talk in the guidance manual about dominant language. And if it's an academic evaluation and the student has received all of their education in English, then that gives a little bit more confidence that English is the best language in which to assess them. But if they have received their education in another language, and then we're using an academic assessment that is, as I said, designed and administered in English, we would need to take the results of that kind of an administration as one piece of the puzzle. And I think that that's really the bottom line of what this guidance manual talks about, is that in the case of a multilingual learner with a suspected disability, you really need to consider many, many different pieces of that puzzle to get a clear picture of that student's abilities and needs. Would you like to add to that, Robin?
No, I just would like to share that you need to be sure that the collaboration piece is always front and everyone's mind between the special education services and the ESOL services. You want to avoid the idea, well, if we identify the student as having special needs, the classes have more students in them than if the student was in an ESOL program and in that class, and looking at it as if it's one service or the other, okay? When if a student is duly identified, they access both services and it's not one or the other, okay? And all students are entitled to what they need. And so we have to look at what's best for the students, not what's best or easiest for the school district. And also keeping in mind that we have students that, you know, can be migratory and be moving. So this idea of, well, they're probably only going to be here for 4 months anyway. By the time we get the evaluation done, they'll probably be moving on. That's not an acceptable state of mind to be using if it is determined that this student, it's in their best interest to be evaluated.
I'm going to read Ian's question next, only because it relates to the previous question, and then I'll go back to Neil's question. So Ian's question is it considered ethical to administer evaluations for special education in English for multilingual learners, or should we find contractors that speak and evaluation tools that are in the student's primary language? So that goes back to what we were talking about before with wanting to use the method that is likely to yield the most meaningful results for a student. And in the guidance manual, we do talk a little bit about using tools that were developed in English and administering them through an interpreter in the student's dominant language. And that is by no means an ideal solution. But in some cases that might yield more meaningful information than an administration of an assessment in English when a student really is not at the point where they can engage with that administration meaningfully. So I would say that it is dependent on that specific student, their language profile, and what would be most likely to yield meaningful results for them.
And also that the evaluator works with the interpreter to be sure that if you're going to go that route, that the interpreter understands what the expectations are of the evaluator and what their job is in the role of the evaluation.
An ideal situation would be that the tool has been created in the language that the student uses and that the person who is administering that tool speaks that language and is a qualified administrator of the tool. That's the dream scenario. But that rarely happens, especially for the languages that are most common in Maine. For other states where Spanish is the predominant language, it might be easier to find a person who's qualified to do that. And there are a small handful of people here in Maine who have those skills and qualifications. But for most of the languages that students speak here in Maine, that's not the case.
Yeah, thank you. Are there efforts underway to sort of procure speakers of, you know, Somali and Burundi and so on, the kinds of languages that we get here? Are there efforts underway to sort of get people who speak those languages and get them qualified in these kinds of evaluations?
I know that individual schools are thinking in those terms and trying to encourage multilingual members of their communities to become trained to do such things. But I'm not sure that there's really a broad effort towards that at this point from the department or elsewhere. But our school counseling mental health specialist, Bear Shea, may have more information if you want to reach out to him and see if he's aware of things that I might not be aware of. And then the next question is about self-regulation. So it says, I'm curious about how teams are addressing self-regulation needs of multilingual learners on a pre-referral basis in terms of determining possible factors that contribute strategies for classroom teachers to implement. As an occupational therapist, I've seen many examples of students with self-regulation concerns that diminished after exposure to a more structured environment for a period of time, after which we're also able to see many more skills emerging. So I think the guidance manual probably answers this question as best as it can be answered, which is to say that if you're seeing self-regulation concerns in a student, that whereas for a student who's spent their entire life here and has had their full education here and is has experienced that stability, self-regulation concerns might cause an educator to conclude certain things. But for a student who hasn't had that stability, and as you said, hasn't had that structured environment for a length of time and may have been exposed to significant trauma, may have cultural factors that are involved, and of course, linguistic factors that are involved, there are a lot of questions that would need to be asked before jumping to the conclusion that it might be a potential disability.
That's very, very helpful. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms. Perkins, because I think that's a big question that school teams come across and could be quite murky at times. You know, kids are very complex and they come to schools with very different backgrounds. But that's very helpful that we need to really approach it thoughtfully.
Welcome and thank you. I think sometimes too that as educators, we want to meet the student's needs as quickly as we possibly can. And in the case of a student who's really struggling emotionally or behaviorally, we want to meet those needs right away because that can pose a safety issue for them or for other students. And so special education might be the place where teachers feel comfortable turning to say, okay, this student needs additional support. Can it be gotten in this way? But I think that, as we said, it's important to ask questions about all of the factors of the student's life before a jumping to the conclusion that special education is the right place for them to get that support.
Yeah, as a school-based OT, I find myself in an interesting position because, you know, when a child presents with self-regulation concerns, a lot of times it affects their posture, their capacity to engage in, you know, motor aspects of a seated task. So a lot of times people sort of raise the question, is this OT? And I think it's sort of reconfiguring OT on a pre-referral basis for multilingual learners and thinking about, okay, what's the bag of tricks we can use to help kids who haven't had that stability or entering a busy school building could be like a, you know, really intense traumatic experience and how to address those pieces. But thank you very, very much.
I just also like to add how important it is for all students, no matter what their age, to feel safe in their environment and the investment that a district makes to be sure that the student understands the protocols within the building, the safety measures, how things work, the investment that you make in that, no matter what the age, really helps and pays for itself in terms of the amount of support services that might be provided. So a student that comes in and doesn't understand any English and a big loud bell goes off and everybody's, you know, going out of the room or all of a sudden, you know, the ceiling talks and everybody's, you know, hiding and they don't understand that's going to perhaps to create some behaviors.
Absolutely. Thank you, Ms. Fleck. Yeah, absolutely. Very, very important point.
A question that came to me directly is, are there expectations for older life students, which are students with limited or interrupted formal education, in terms of expected rate of growth? And I would say that there's not a standard set of expectations that we can point to and say, this is how a life student should be progressing. It really is very individual to that student, because when we say life, that can mean a wide range of things. And we are currently working on developing and finalizing a state definition of SLIFE that I hope to have available for you all very soon, which most likely is going to say that they've had two or more years less schooling than their peers. So 2 years less schooling or 10 years less schooling than peers, there's a very big difference between those two scenarios. So as I said, not one standard set of expectations for growth, but I think the more that schools gain experience in serving life, the more basis for comparison that they may have. And one of the things that the guidance manual touches on is this concept of a true peer. So if you're looking to understand if the student is making expected or reasonable growth in a reasonable amount of time, one tool in the toolkit is to compare them to a student who has a similar profile. And so the more SLIFE students that we are serving in Maine schools, the greater chance we have of being able to identify that true peer that we might compare them to see is one growing more quickly than the other and what factors might be at play there. And then another question, and this may be the last one. It says, the challenge we're finding is pre-K and K students. It may be unclear if they're proficient in their native language or in English. So what to do for special education testing, what language to use or to use an interpreter or not. So that's okay, Erin, for the typos, I understand. And again, the guidance manual talks about all of those possible scenarios, whether to administer it solely in English, to administer it through an interpreter. But I think it always comes down to the same response, which is that you want to make sure to do it in a way that makes sense for that student, that would be likely to yield the most meaningful results for them, and to always consider any administration, whatever language it's administered in, through whatever means, as a piece of the puzzle, so that you're also considering all of the other kinds of evidence that we talked about during today's session.
May I ask a follow-up question? Erin, are you referring to a situation that might be like a parent reports that, you know, the child just started speaking at age 4?
No, not like delayed. No, it's more like parents have said, like, well, they don't really speak it. They do a little bit, but they understand. So they're identified as a multilingual learner, but they're not fully speaking their native language, but they're not fully speaking English, you know, they're babies. So we have some that have been like, they come to us through CDS, and now they're needing testing, and the special ed providers are saying to me, do you think I should get an interpreter? And I'm like, I don't know that they'll understand the interpreter, but they're not going to fully get it in English either. So it's just this year, the challenge since the pandemic, they're coming in totally different than they ever have.
Yeah, that's a scenario that I think is quite common, actually, here, what you described, because many families might speak another language in the home, but speak to the child in English, and the child speaks English because that's the language around them the most. And when they're outside of the home, that's the language of the environment. So they're not completely solid in English or in the language that's spoken in their home. That is a common scenario. And in those cases, it can be difficult to determine which method would be best for administering any kind of evaluation. You might have to attempt multiple ways of assessing the child in order to get a clear picture.
Right. What I said, I'm like, we can get the interpreter and see, because we want to make sure we're being equitable and that the child has the best shot at, you know, finding, you know, giving what they know, but they may not know, but we can try.
and sometimes a hybrid approach might work best, that they are there is an interpreter present, but the student might choose to respond to assessment items in English if that's the language that they most often use. It does require, as we said earlier, a little bit of flexibility and thinking outside of the box to get the evidence that we need.
Mm-hmm. The other thing we're finding this year is children being over-identified because they were evaluated over Zoom. And they're coming to us with these IEPs and I'm like, what are you talking about? That's not that child. And we've had to really reevaluate and see what the truth is.
Well, I mean, the pandemic in general certainly throws a little more complications.
Thank you.
Thanks, Erin.
So we are reaching the end of our hour, and I'm sure that probably many others of you have questions that you didn't have an opportunity to ask. So I want to make sure to screen share one more time and give our contact information for you all. And also ask that you complete a feedback form for us, if you wouldn't mind. So there's the feedback form. You can use the QR code or the link, and maybe I can drop the link into the chat as well in just a moment. And then our contact information is here. So, of course, Robin and I are here today. Leora Byers is our colleague on the Special Services and Inclusive Education team, who has been working with us closely to complete the guidance manual and to roll it out for everyone. So you're also very welcome to reach out to her. And I'll go back for just a moment to that feedback form in case anyone still needs to grab that. Whoops. Never mind. Okay. And with that, we thank you so much for spending this hour with us. We know you're very, very busy, and we appreciate that you were able to prioritize this time to learn about the guidance manual. And we hope to see you at the next session, which is on what date, Robin? Forgive me for not knowing off the top of my head.
It is December 7th, okay. 3 p.m.
So, and the link to register for that second session will be in the weekly newsletter, which will go out tomorrow since Friday is a holiday. And it's also on the Multilingual Learners page of the website. And let me grab the feedback form chat for you. Feedback form and put it in the chat. And Robin, you can go ahead and stop the recording.
Okay.
Okay, there's the feedback.